Are you not doing business as usual? Then email us at neotropolis.org. Tell us how you're changing your business, organization, or government agency to compete in the new economy. And who knows, you could be starring on Neotropolis, not business as usual. So we took a look at sustainable energy from a microeconomic point of view. Now we talk with experts in the field for a macroeconomic perspective, or what we like to call fly-eye economics.
With over 4,000 lenses, the eyes of a common housefly are among the most complex in the insect world.
With us tonight, our panelist, Will Hemker, entrepreneur executive with the University of Akron Research Foundation, and Dr. Ajay Mahajan, associate dean for research in the College of Engineering with the University of Akron. Gentlemen, thanks so much for being with us tonight. You know, there was a time when, before electricity, people used waterfalls to generate power and run equipment. Why have we maybe gotten, we still have that, but why have we gotten seemingly so far away from that technology?
Well, it starts out as, I think you'd have to say, it's cheap oil.
Yeah.
We went into the internal combustion engine, and whether that be gasoline or diesel driven, and they do a lot of work for us. Not only just move us around from place to place in our automobiles, but they use quite heavily to generate electricity, even as backup power and remote power sources. So, you know, that's probably the simplest reason. Now that we have a challenge to come up with alternatives because of the price of on petroleum being so high or going up so high, is really gives us back to some of the basics that our forefathers used, and I think we see that in this application.
Yeah, it's almost a new time. It's almost like the Wild West for alternate energy, and so you see a lot of clever and innovative devices coming into the market that pretty much do what we were doing 2,000 years ago. But hopefully doing it in a clever way, in a more innovative way, and giving a real alternative to oil.
Well, we always hear about the wind and solar for renewable energy sources, and the folks at GEC have come up with this unique concept, as they have. Talk about its uniqueness and the impact it could have on business and jobs in Northeast Ohio.
Well, I'm relatively new at it, and I'm not really an engineer. I'll let Asia get into
sure.
that. But basically, I'm an industrial scientist in the areas of more materials, such as polymers and the like. But I was introduced to them about a little over a month ago. And I was impressed. And number one, their know-how and their ability to reduce it to practice. And as you've shown in your videos, some of their prototypes are amazing. What they really have there is unique transmission. Taking a low energy source in one machine is actually uses human power, which is, you know, a fraction of a horsepower that humans can generate in the work aspect, and transmit that energy using a pendulum as an efficient medium to assist that energy development of that low energy source, and transfer it very efficiently into another straight work source, whether it be pumping of fluids or whether they be directly connected into a generator that can generate more usable, transferable energy, such as electricity. So you know, that's what's unique about them. They've taken some of the old world ideas and then have put in some very good machining and very low friction bearings and movement parts into that transmission. So it's really a transmission medium.
Yeah, I think the design's quite clever. This is one of those designs that you can actually call clever, because it converts the pendulum motion into a reciprocating motion.
Mm-hmm.
So as the pendulum goes from left to right, you can actually see a motion, a back and forth motion. And because of the momentum of the pendulum, they can get a pretty good reciprocating motion that can then be used to either generate power or pump water or filter water. So from an engineering point of view, certainly it's unique, it's innovative. The trick now is to convert it into a business. I think that's where the challenge lies.
Exactly, and that's, you know, how I was introduced to them. These guys are very clever and very sharp, hands-on engineers. The aspect is they know they need a little help. I mean, to get this idea out of their prototyping workshop into a viable business, and that's one thing we're trying to put together right now: a business plan that basically the people out there, potential customers, are also investors. Can read and understand, and the language that they need to understand it. And that's basically what we do as entrepreneurs through the Research Foundation. And so myself and a partner, Sherry Waxman, who's one of my colleagues, she's very good at that in industrial applications and the mechanics, and she's right in on it, and we're going to see if we can help them out.
Yeah. And they've got a few things going for them. In Northeast Ohio, this really is a good time to be doing these kinds of things. you know, Northeast Ohio, Western Pennsylvania have been recognized by the U.S. Department of Commerce as a regional innovation cluster, okay. as an RIC, in two areas, biosciences and clean energy technologies. So that immediately gives us the leverage that you need to say, okay, look, this is a cluster. These people are not alone. These companies are not alone. There's a plethora of companies out here that are doing similar kinds of things, and that gives the momentum. So that's a good thing. Through Will and his colleagues, they can be plugged into the Archangels network and other such investor networks. Again, right place, right time. They just need a little bit of help to really get them on that path.
Once they gain some momentum, what's their message to perhaps businesses out there? Hey, this is what we're doing. This can really benefit you.
The message is it's doable. All right. You first of all, you have to be a passionate. You have a creative idea and a design. They've done that so far. Now they know that they need to get other experts involved in their venture. People that can literally come on board, help be part of their management team, that can take them forward and make them very investable. Also, that network that we provide here in the region, not only obviously the universities that we're connected with, but also other businesses, large and small. Also, the investors. The businesses right now, or any time, they really don't want to invest very early stage. It's too risky. But there are people that are out there that do that, whether they be angel investors or venture capitalists. But even though we also have regional sources, regional government and funds that provide grants and other business resources. You have angel investor networks. We have state funding, such as the Third Frontier, which is very effective in our state. And obviously, national. If we identify potential federal government agencies that would like that, for example, the military is looking very much to reduce their carbon footprint, the amount of petroleum they have to use to support their soldiers or their forces out in the field. This would be a great medium for them to get in. That would be a potential customer for gravity-assisted power.
How might this impact jobs?
I think tremendously. I mean, this is a fundamental machine that if the whole machine could be built in the area showing real value or important components even, using those strengths of Northeast Ohio, which is, you know, the machining, the materials. These guys have a lot of know-how. They've been there before. I think they just need a little assistance.
Yeah, one of the challenges is going to be identifying their early penetration markets, right? Okay. So this may not be a machine that you and I will go out and buy today.
Correct.
But this certainly could be a machine or a device that could be used in a third world country or could be used in areas that don't have access to electricity. And so getting those early successes for this company would be absolutely critical, because once they can penetrate the market, doesn't matter where you penetrate it, once you identify it, penetrate it, then they can start creating these devices and start creating jobs, as you mentioned.
And a global impact, of course. You mentioned third world countries. They're already they've already implemented their device in Haiti to produce water. The military connection as well now that they're pursuing, and it could really be a global thing.
I think it can be. It reminds me of a nonprofit. I forget their name, but they use the children's merry-go-rounds to generate power, and they've installed hundreds, if not thousands. In fact, they were sponsored by a lot of companies that really saw the merit in that idea. And they've installed hundreds of them in Africa. And just the energy harnessed by the kids using the merry-go-round is enough to power a building. Not a huge building, but enough to not want electricity from the outside. So I think this certainly could be a device or a machine that could fit in that category, where you have somebody swinging it back and forth, and you're pumping water, and you're cleaning it, and it's there for a few people to drink.
And you realize that in these many parts of the world, the amount of electricity needed is very low, but it's needed because their cell phone systems are there, they're in place. You know, things such as lighting at night, just for the, sure. They can go beyond the regular sunlight for business or schools. So, you know, they need electricity. How can we get it to them?
There you are. Great stuff. Gentlemen, thanks so much for joining us. Appreciate your time tonight.
You're welcome.